So today's Congressman Trey Gowdy pressed Rosenstein on the reports of bias on the Mueller-Russia investigative team. Here's a bit more of that.
So let's be really clear why we have special counsel. There was either a real or perceived conflict of interest that we were fearful would either impact the result or people's confidence in the process. And then lo and behold, those who are supposed to make sure there are no conflicts of interest seem to have a few of their own. There's a senior prosecutor who sent obsequious emails to a fact witness. She's a really important fact witness if you pursue the line of inquiry that my Democrat friends want to pursue. They got off of collusion, and now they're on obstruction of justice.
So here exclusively on The Story tonight, House Judiciary Member Trey Gowdy. Congressman, welcome. I believe
yes,
that you were referring to Sally Yates there and
yes,
the
ma'am.
Email that she received from Andrew Weissman congratulating her on not defending the Trump ban and saying that he was in awe of her, I think are the words he used. So you pressed Rod Rosenstein on this today. Were you satisfied with the answer that you got to that question?
A little bit, but you know, he was explaining all day. This is a really bad fact pattern. I hate it for Rod Rosenstein that he's the one explaining it, because he's not Peter Strzok and he's not Andy McCabe and he's not Jim Comey, so he's having to do a little bit of cleanup. But these are really bad facts if you care about an impartial, objective Department of Justice and FBI.
All right, I want to go to the other part of the text messages that goes to this question of conspiracy, because as Ed Henry laid out, the timeline on all of this is very problematic. This is a text message from Peter Strzok to Lisa Page. I want to believe the path you threw out for consideration in Andy's office, that there's no way he gets elected, but I'm afraid we can't take that risk. It's like an insurance policy in the unlikely event that you die before you're 40. Now, you know, obviously everyone's going to try to figure out what he was going to do to make sure that you couldn't take that risk. But it would help everyone to understand that at the time that he said that, he was investigating Hillary Clinton to decide whether or not they were going to pursue charges against her.
Yes, ma'am. I'm still trying to figure out why three FBI agents are discussing politics in the deputy director's office, because you're not supposed to discuss politics on federal ground, and FBI agents aren't supposed to engage in politics for Hatch Act reasons. Remember, we were supposed to interview Andy McCabe yesterday on another committee. It was all set up and ready to go, and then at the last minute, they said, he can't come Tuesday. He's going to come next week. I'll be shocked if he comes next week. I'll be a little bit surprised if he's still an employee of the FBI this time next week. But the notion that three bureau agents would be conspiring or plotting on how to handle the outcome of a presidential election is the opposite of what you want in an objective, dispassionate, neutral FBI.
All right, so you said that when you go home to South Carolina next week, you're going to get a lot of questions about all of this.
Yes, ma'am.
And I would imagine that your constituents are going to want to know, so what happens? You know, what happens now? How are they going to right this ship?
They will want to know that, and they will want to know whether or not we can trust or rely upon what Robert Mueller comes up with. And I have been very defensive of Robert Mueller from day one, even up until as recently as a week ago. But he hired some people that have terrible bias, and he didn't have to. There are plenty of women and men who don't contribute to political campaigns. There are plenty of prosecutors he could have hired. So at some point, Bob Mueller's going to have to explain, how did he vet these prosecutors and agents? How did these folks slip by? Because what's going to happen, Martha, is if he decides to do something to the Trump campaign or prosecute President Trump, Republicans have a built-in argument for bias, that the fix was in from day one. And if he clears President Trump, then the Democrats are going to say, well, the pressure from the Republicans was so unrelenting. He's in a no-win situation, but he's there because of some of the decisions he's made.
Yeah. Do you think that conspiracy point that we just talked about, does that lay the groundwork for any Hatch Act investigation, do you think, before I let you go?
Well, I think using an official phone to discuss politics is a Hatch Act violation. That's my old job, but it is incredibly problematic that you are in the deputy. Remember, Jim Comey gets very sanctimonious when you talk to him about a politicized FBI. Very sanctimonious. Well, guess what? In his deputy director's office, they were discussing how to prevent one candidate from becoming president of the United States. It doesn't get any more political than that.
That they wanted some kind of insurance policy against that potential eventuality, which they obviously all found an atrocious idea. Trey Gowdy.
Almost as bad as Ted Cruz.
Almost as bad, right? Congressman, thank you so much.